Hello students, I am Partha Chakravarti from University of Delhi, Department of Geology. Today our topic of discussion will be hydrocarbon trap. Now once you will go through this module of hydrocarbon trap, you will be able to know that what are the different geometries of the trap, what are the major force that makes a reservoir into trap, how really we think of a trap and when the different kind of structure or permeability barrier that makes a reservoir into trap, and how a hydrocarbon exploration person will look into this trap that it is a exploration target. Now coming on to the definition of trap, I have also again discussed this issue of trap when I discuss the reservoir petrophysics and other the migration aspect of the hydrocarbon. But today our main goal is to discuss the trap. So I reiterate the discussion a little bit what I discussed in other module also. That a trap is that part of a reservoir where the physical entrapment of oil has taken place. So a trap has two major goals. That number one, it should allow entry of hydrocarbon, and number two, it should prevent the escapement or exit of the hydrocarbon. So a trap necessarily means that there should be a caprock with the reservoir. And what is a caprock? Caprock is a rock of very low permeability. So when we talk of a reservoir, that a reservoir is that which has a good porosity and permeability that allows it to hold hydrocarbon as well as the migration of hydrocarbon. Whereas a caprock is that which is of very low permeability, which do not allow the migration, further migration of the hydrocarbon or escape of hydrocarbon from the reservoir, and thereby cause the entrapment of the hydrocarbon within the reservoir. Now a caprock may not be 100% impermeable. The question is at what rate, if it is not 100% impermeable, then at what rate it is allowing escape? If the rate of entry of hydrocarbon within the reservoir is more than the rate of escape through the caprock, then also a hydrocarbon accumulation will happen within the reservoir and we call it a trap. Now, how really we define the different parameters of a trap? That question comes, and that I will explain in form of a drawing in board of an anti-formal trap situation when you have a closure of IA antiform, and then how I define the different physical parameters of a trap. Students, this is a very simple geometry of an antiformal trap, where I can have a closure of the antiform and where you can see that there is accumulation of gas and oil. Now this, generally in nature, most of the reservoirs, they are water wet. And then when oil, it enters into the reservoir, it displaces water. It displaces water and oil moves to the top because of lower density and thereby displaces the water from the higher altitude within the trap. And that water moves to the down and get accumulated in the lower part of the antiform. So when I have gas here, I have oil here, and you develop the water that will be pushed down and to the side, and as there is a trap, there must be the impermeable rock, which is, suppose it, that may be a shale which will be surrounding this reservoir rock, which is acting as a cap rock. So this impermeability, both above and as well as the sidewise, that will not allow the hydrocarbon to be escaping from this trap, and the water will be pushed down sideward as well as bottomward. The water which we get just exactly to the bottom, we call that the bottom water, and what water what we get to the edge or the sidewise, that we call the edge water. Now, what is a spill point? A spill point is the minimum structural contour in an antiform up to which there can be the accumulation of hydrocarbon. So that is what is a spill point or a spill plane. So spill plane is essentially, I repeat again, it is the lowermost structural level up to which the hydrocarbon can occupy space within a antiformal trap. That is what is the spill point. And the highest point of the antiform, its height from the spill point, that shows that is called the closure of the structure. So that what we call the entire closure, which is available for becoming a trap, provided this has a reservoir quality, there is a cap rock, and we have a source rock from where the hydrocarbon is being supplied within the reservoir rock. Now, situation may not be the entire structural closure, may not entire structural relief of an antiform may not be equivalent to that of a closure. Suppose the thing in the case of a monocline. Think of a monocline. In a monocline, what you can see, this is what is closure in a monocline. Whereas, this becomes the structural closure of a monocline. So you can see there is a distinct difference between the closure, there is the structural and the trap closure. So structural closure and the trap closure, this may not be similar when we get a monocline, and here it is a case which is a classical case where the trap closure and the structural closure may be same, but it is not that in case of here we have shown that the structural closure and the trap closure, they are different from one another. Okay, so now what are the different ways the traps can be formed? The question comes there. We know there are traps which are formed by different ways. Suppose there is a structural trap which are formed by the deformation in rock. There are stratigraphic traps which are formed because of the permeability difference between the two parts of the, that is the phases change during the deposition and permeability variation. I can also have trap formation by the diagenetic process, by the increase in the dissolution and the more porosity development. The traps are also formed in form of some combination, that is a combination of the structure and the stratigraphy that makes the formation of the combination trap. All these different varieties of traps that is existing in nature. Now, I come to a discussion that what in a trap we refer that in the form of a gross pay and the net pay. Now, coming on to this kind of a situation, let us think of a situation where I get a intertanging relationship of the two faces, that is a sandstone and shell. So a sandstone and shell, it shows a intertanging relationship. I get a sandstone and then you get a shell which is a intertanging relationship. The entire thing then it deformed. So if the entire thing is deformed now, then you get the shape of this deform, because if you put pressure and there is deformation, then you get it like this. I have just drawn that here and try to explain you what is the meaning of the gross pay and the net pay. Now, if you see this reservoir here, this is the total, this portion is filled by oil. So, you call the total payable part of the reservoir, that is what is called the gross pay. That means that portion of the reservoir from which the hydrocarbon can be extracted or recoverable, that you call the gross pay. But is the entire gross pay will be available for the recovery of the hydrocarbon? No, that is not always so. Here is a case where you can see that the oil water contact here, oil water contact here, oil water contact here. So, all these three together, they will be extractable. And then, if the total gross pay I consider L, and this I consider L1, this one L2, then this is L3, then L1 plus L2 plus L3, this becomes the actual recoverable hydrocarbon from the reservoir, which we call the net pay. Net pay. So, the gross pay, that is the total reservoir from which the hydrocarbon can be recoverable, and net pay, which actually is recovered and which is that is what is called the net pay. So, net pay will always be less than the gross pay in a particular reservoir. Okay, we again come to that discussion what I was discussing, that is the different kinds of trap formation. First, we come onto the structural trap formation. In structural trap formation, the traps can be formed by both folding as well as faulting. The folding trap formation, they can be of two major types. One is compressional and number two, contractional. In compressional, as I have discussed, that you get the formation of the antiformal and the syn-formal structure, and there are many examples that it is a structural folding or the compressional regime, that is the fold belt or the fold thrust belt, where we get the accumulation of the hydrocarbon. Some beautiful example is the Zagros mountain in the Iran, or where you get the beautiful accumulation, several accumulation in the limestone, and the shale sequence, the limestone acts as the reservoir, and that is a folded strata. But one thing is very important, that just by simple formation of antiform or synform, we do not get the accumulation of hydrocarbon. There must be a apical culmination within the antiform. That means the axial axis, the fold axis, should have a culmination to give us a closure where the hydrocarbon get accumulated. And that closure condition that we achieve because of the compressional tectonics within the particular area. So, that is number one, the compression. The second one that we get, that we may get, that there is a growth dome. Then what is a growth dome? That any subsurface structure, that if, suppose I have a horst graben kind of structure, or there is a salt dome, which, or there is a basinal high, so any kind of structure, and then above that if you have a sedimentation, and that sedimentation will cause the differential compaction in the different part of the basin, and that differential compaction also can cause some kind of the uplifted zone, which can act as a closure. So, that is another form, rather than the simple tectonics, that is what is the compressional, we also get that contractional, that is very important to that. So, we were discussing the folded the trap that is formed by the compression, and we discussed that the trap or that by the compression, that can be an anticlinal trap, and also it the trap can be formed because of the salt dome, as we know, salt dome, and it can be as a growth dome. The salt dome is that any subsurface salt structure and the bending of the strata above that, or it can be a basement high, above that the strata it get bended. So then the either it is a salt, or I can have a basement, which is there is a basement high and the strata above that follows the basement. So all these that can create a some kind of a closure, and that closure is all considered under this. Growth dome, that is also possible when you have a penny contemporaneous, that is with the sedimentation, there is some kind of fault that is growing, and there is the growth of the fault and the upliftment above that fault. So that also comes under the growth dome. Now coming on to the fault related traps, the fault related trap, we can have the normal fault related trap, we can have the reverse fault related trap, or the thrust related trap. Now these traps, they basically form in both hanging wall as well as the foot wall of the, depending upon the how the fault is acting as a seal. Now we know the fault is a very ambiguous thing. It can either act as a seal or it can act as a passage for any kind of seepage. It all depend on that how the fault is behaving, what is the nature of the fault gauge and the fault brecciation product. So all these essentially indicates that there may be a kind of sealing effect which causes the fault. So I can have a this may be a reservoir which is faulted and it has come in the contact of a so what we get that if there is a fault and it is a, as I am showing, there is a normal fault, so this is the reservoir strata which is down thrown, and by its down thrown it has come in contact with the impermeable strata on the side. So it is now becoming a seal. It is acting that the hydrocarbon cannot escape through this way because this is the impermeable rock. So there is an accumulation of hydrocarbon. Here the fault is acting as a seal, and thereby it is accumulating a kind of hydrocarbon against the seal. The same thing can happen when you have a reverse fault. You have a reverse fault. Have a reverse fault, and this reverse fault, so you may have the this may also happen in case of a reverse fault, that the formation of the fault as a seal, and that seal causes the entrapment of the hydrocarbon. The situation can be something like this as well. A faulted limb of an antiform. What we can see that this antiform, the one limb is faulted, and that fault has caused the entrapment of hydrocarbon, because originally the antiform that might have been, there is an entrapment there, and because of this fault some more traps that has been formed in the other structural level of that fault. Well, that is what we have shown, that this is the two trap formation. One is because of the antiformal and the closure, and second is because of the sealing effect of the fault. So you can see that the two structural effect and the formation of the two traps into that structure. So depending on the amount of throw in the fault and the thickness of the bed, the amount of closure, whether it is an unlimited closure or it is a limited closure, that is defined. Suppose think of a normal fault. Think of a normal fault. That this is so the bed is dipping in the same direction as the fault. So this is a fault, the bed is dipping in the same direction as the fault, and also the amount of throw, it is much more than the bed thickness, much more than the bed thickness. In that case, we will be getting a unlimited closure. But when the throw is less than the thickness, then what will happen? That there will be very limited closure when the throw is less than the bed thickness. Same thing you will see, we will see that when it is a, instead of normal fault, it is a reverse fault. here the hanging wall going up, and the amount of throw is much higher than the thickness of the bed, then again you have a unlimited closure. But again, in that case, if I have the amount of throw that is less than the bed thickness, then what we get? We get the spill point to be formed. Spill point to be formed. Okay? Now, if we have that the bed deep differs, this is what we are discussing, that this is the thrust fault. Now the bed deep differs, then what will happen in case of a normal fault? Normal fault with large amount of throw, but bed deep is opposite to the deep of the fault, then again you get a unlimited closure. And you have the normal fault with the amount of throw is less than the bed thickness, you have the limited closure. So my intention is to tell you is that whether it is a normal fault or it is a reverse fault, depending upon what is the amount of throw and what is the deep of the bed, we will get the limited or unlimited closure and the formation of different kind of trap. Now, once we are through this, there are four different kind of cases that may appear depending upon what is the genetic connotation of the fault and what is the relationship of the fault formation and the sedimentation history. If the fault is prior to the sedimentation in a basin and the formation of the reservoir, the fault will have no role in the formation of trap in the reservoir. In that case, we call that fault as a dead fault. We can have fault which is continuing during the sedimentation process and thereby form the trap. That is a kind of fault we call the continuing fault. We also get the young fault. In young fault, what happens that during the late stage of sedimentation or immediately after sedimentation, the young fault system, it will generate, and depending upon case to case basis, it may generate trap or may not generate trap. Of course, the continuing fault is one of the best for the trap formation. We can also have the late in the history, the fault which is formed, that is the formation of the reservoir, formation of the trap, and after that some faulting is taking place. If that happens, that the after the trap formation the faulting takes place, in that case, instead of helping in trap formation, it will be damaging the trap formation, and the hydrocarbon will escape through that fault and we will not get hydrocarbon in that trap. Now, coming on to some other mechanism of the trap formation, that one major mechanism, that is what is called the diapiric mechanism. That is the density contrast. It can be the salt which through density contrast the buoyed up, or it can be the mud diapir. Now, there are different kinds of traps which are also associated with the salt dome formation, and which is very important in case of a deltaic setting. Then if there is a salt dome formation, there are different kinds of the traps that get formed. We can have the faults which is generated at the top. Actually, what happens that the salt, being of lower density than the overlying sediment, it buoys up at a very slow speed, what we call the halokinetics. And normally we get this kind of when the salt deposit is more than 100 meter in thickness. Some important example of that is the Permian Jackstein, that in the North Sea. And then you know that the Permian and the Jurassic time, that is some of the best evaporite formation, and that the best evaporite formation that forms salt dome formation. Now, if there is a salt dome that is buoyed up, then you get the hydrocarbon reserves at the top. You also get the hydrocarbon reserve because of the upward sweep of different strata. There may be unconformity also. It may cut across unconformity, and then you may get some growth faults, which may also be associated with that growth fault, which is also very important in a deltaic setting, which creates a large number of the trap formation. The growth fault is very good in forms of the trap formation because it is continuous during the sedimentation history within the delta. So the salt dome and its formation of the hydrocarbon is one of the best considered as the trap formation mechanism in the geological history. We can also have the trap formation. We can also have the trap formation because of the sub-basement fractures. Now there is a case that there is fractures in the basement, and you have the impermeable shell above it. So we may get the fracture system. It can also generate the trap in the basin. Now I come on to the stratigraphic trap. The stratigraphic trap, it forms because of the permeability difference. There can be different kind of stratigraphic trap formation. I just draw some examples of the stratigraphic trap when you have a sandstone which is pinching out within the shell. You may also have, this is a granite, and then you may have, this is shell and the sandstone is, this acts as a trap. So there is shell. There is a wedge out. We may also get some form of the channel, the shell, the sandstone, that may be the oil bearing, the channelized. There may be the carbonate, that is the reef structure, where you can have the lot of void spaces, that the reef. All these are either due to deposition and the facies change and the permeability variation, or it may be some kind of diagenetic process that is operative after the deposition and making the more void formation and the dissolution. Both the ways that the stratigraphy that can cause the trap formation. So we divide it that number one, the primary stratigraphic trap formation, primary, and number two, the secondary. The primary stratigraphic trap, that what? The facies change, the wedge out, the pinch out, all these are the primary stratigraphic trap formation. Whereas the diagenetic way, the changes that happen within the trap and thereby it help in the hydrocarbon accumulation, then you call it a secondary trap formation. Now, besides this all, there is another way of the trap formation, that is what is called the hydrodynamic trap formation. So, what is a hydrodynamic trap? If you see, the hydrodynamic trap is that where entrapment is not because of any closure or not because of any major permeability variation, but it is because of the movement of water within the reservoir. So, if I have, there is movement of water, and that movement of water causes the hydrocarbon to be accumulated within the reservoir. That is basically called the hydrodynamic reservoir. Normally the oil water contact, I have already discussed earlier about when we discussed about the secondary migration, that when there is a water flow, we all expect that the oil water contact, it may not be horizontal, that will be inclined. And in many cases that the oil and gas, they will be detached from one another. So those things we have already discussed, and that this movement of water commonly is responsible for that kind of, but if there is a significant movement of water for a long period of time, then the oil get degraded, and that degradation of oil may create asphalt. So that asphalt again acts as a cap, and because that is impermeable. So overall, if there is a hydrodynamic trap and that entrapment is happening because of the movement of water and that is operative for a long period of time, there will be a huge damage of the oil pool that we often see in different kind of situation. So, students, we have discussed with you the different kinds of trapping mechanism. We have discussed that what is meaning of the stratigraphic trap, how the stratigraphic trap is operative. We have discussed the meaning of the structural trap. There are traps which are a combination of the structure and stratigraphy, that is what we call the combination trap. So most of the traps, many traps, they are basically combination trap, because only stratigraphy may not be giving you the full scale trap and the closure. So once the stratigraphically you have the permeability difference, then you make a structure out of it that becomes the most beautiful situation for the trap formation. Salt dome, that also is a very important process. Salt dome, that is the halokinetic process, is a very important process. And the entrapment, even in the basement, provided the basement is covered by a impermeable shell, then the basement is fractured. In that case, we may get even the entrapment of oil in the basement. We also get the formation of trap by means of the hydrodynamic process, that is the movement of water within the reservoir, and thereby formation, accumulation of the oil. So all this process that makes a reservoir trap. A reservoir, as I discussed, is only defined by its porosity and permeability as the petrophysical property, but the entrapment procedure, that requires a closure, that requires a permeability barrier. So all these that makes a reservoir into a trap, and that trap is essentially controlled not only by the closure, also by the presence of the cap rock. As I discussed, that the compacted shale, the evaporite, that the very densely cemented sandstone or carbonate, anything can act as a cap rock provided its permeability is very, very low. So all these factors that is responsible for a potential trap formation. So I believe that you have enjoyed the discussion of trap, that how a reservoir can become a trap and help us in the hydrocarbon exploration process. Thank you.